Recording now.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to EDP and Applied Mathematics Seminar. It's a pleasure for me to open session 22 of this seminar. Today we have two excellent speakers, Enrique Baldinosi and Anderson Ramos. Introducing Enrico Baldinosi, we have to Professor Marcelo Cavalcanti. Thank you, Marcelo. You can start.
Thank you, Juan. Thank you, Enrique, for accepting our invitation. It's my great pleasure to introduce you, Professor Enrico Baldinosi, from the University of Western Australia. He has received his PhD in 2002 in the University of Texas, Austin, under the supervision of Professor Luis Caffarelli. Professor Baldinosi possesses 224 publications, including two books, and around 7,000 citations from MathSciNet. And according to MathSciNet, also more than 5 students of PhD students. So the title of his talk is The Levine Flight Foraging Hypothesis Revisit. Professor, go ahead. Thank you.
Muito obrigado, Marcelo e Juan. The talk I will present is inspired by some biological model. So the idea is that animals try to look for food, and one can imagine that due to biological competition, they try to optimize this search. So in a sense, biology is also inspiring for a number of practical purposes, because search strategies are nowadays used in a number of things. For instance, the search engines in the web, unfortunately also military targets and so on. But the main assumption that I'm going to discuss a bit today is called the Levine Flight Foraging Hypothesis, which was formulated in the late 1980s. Basically, the idea is that while the classical random walk is based on an exponential, on a Gaussian tail of a distribution, there are other stable distributions that are based on power law tails. And it is possible that this distribution of flights of the animals could optimize the search efficiency by reducing the oversampling. So the idea is, if you see the right picture here is a simulation of a classical random walk. And suppose that an animal follows this pattern when looking for food. Well, one might argue that it's kind of a suboptimal strategy, because the animal returns many times to the same location. So if this location near here is mostly empty, the animal wastes a lot of time in an empty location rather than exploring the environment nearby. So in a sense, it might be more convenient to follow a pattern like the one on the left, in which the animal can jump for, somehow in average, longer distances in order to visit, to explore a larger portion of the environment. Of course, a number of biological questions arose. For instance, is the animal going to perform this alternative search strategy due to memory effect, because the animal learns something about the environment, or because the distributions of the targets is fractal, so the very regular distribution of prey somehow encourages the animal to look in a sort of fractional version to the targets? Or is it possible to connect more solidly the Levi flight strategy with an optimization problem? And a famous breakthrough in this direction was given by a Brazilian group led by Professor Gandhi Viswanathan. And this was a very brilliant intuition in the sense that this group tried to formalize mathematically in a strong and coherent way the idea that animals could follow this Levi flight strategy to search for food in order to maximize some kind of utility function, so to eat more in a sense. And to do this, Viswanathan and collaborators decided to basically act with two strategies. One was the strategy of an applied physicist, if you like, or a biologist, that is checking what the animals were doing in practice. But the other strategy was coexisting with this, and it was the attitude of a pure mathematician that wanted to set a problem in a formal way and to address the question with mathematical optimization techniques. So. The main experiment that they ran involves these birds here that are called wandering albatrosses, and I would like to share. Let me see if I can show a video of that. Yes. Why can't I share this? Let me see. You know, it doesn't allow me to. I did something silly because now I cannot share anymore. I can't believe. Okay. But not at the see. Okay, let me see if I can share it. Can you see the bird?
Not yet. No.
Okay, yeah. I mean, this bird is a wandering albatross. And I think it's kind of cute, but also instructive to see the way the bird flies. It's kind of funny, right? It's a very big bird. It's actually, I think, the largest bird in terms of wing spread. And as you see, starting the flight is kind of an effort for the bird. It really takes some kind of energy. And it's a fact that once it starts flying, it really flies for a very long distance. Of course, going back to the land and start again the process of flying is a pain for this bird. So the more it stays in the air, somehow the better. And so the idea is that the Brazilian group led by Viswanathan put a sensor in the feet of the bird, so that when the bird was diving to eat fish, the sensor was getting wet. And so the idea is that by measuring the time, the different times that the sensors were getting wet, they were measuring the distances traveled by the bird between two different dives. Okay, assuming, for instance, that the bird was flying at a constant speed. Okay, so yes, so. So this basic experiment led the Brazilian team to develop the mathematics related to that, showing that under suitable assumptions, basically under the assumption that the distribution of prey is sparse, so there are very few targets in the landscape. And that the targets were reproducing themselves fast. So as soon as the forager eats the target, then the target is replaced by a new one. Well, under these assumptions, they showed that the inverse square power law distribution corresponding to the Levy flight motion is an optimal strategy. Now, both the experiment and the mathematical statement were also criticized by other scientists, and I would say that still today, the Levy flight foraging hypothesis is under a very intense debate. Of course, there are a number of objections that you can move from the biological point of view to this theory, because first of all, the idea that the evolution, the Darwinistic evolution, is leading to the optimization of the search strategy is still an assumption that needs some verification, because life is so complex. And we cannot really optimize every specific feature of life, right? So it's questionable whether eating is just the main priority that you want to optimize, or you just want to optimize a number of features, which may include also the foraging, but not, it's not limited to that. So reducing the optimization to the search for food may be a little bit too simplistic. Also, in all these Levy models, one is not really taking into account the memory of the predator and the fact that predators usually don't move so randomly, so they don't change direction randomly. So once the predator is going in a given direction, the next flight will remember usually or arguably the previous direction that the forager was taking, while the classical random walks are a little bit too random, maybe in the choice of the next direction of motion. Also, the comparison between Levy and Brownian movements is a little bit perhaps too restrictive, because there could be other situations in which maybe the two movements coexist, or other kind of motions are taken into account. Also, the foraging strategy may have to take into account other parameters like the mobility of the prey, the environmental condition, and so on. And I mean, a very important feature that is always overlooked is that it's always difficult to check these arguments experimentally. For several reasons. So first of all, you have to take an animal, probably you have to fill a number of forms for ethics and so on. Once you take the animal, you have to implant the sensor. And this is, I mean, technically very difficult and expensive. And actually, many of these experiments were run with a very low number of animals, exactly because of these reasons. And above all, it's very difficult to distinguish what the animal is doing. So one of the first experiments was assuming that these albatrosses were going to fish. But actually, after a bit, another experiment discovered that many of these albatrosses were not going to fish, but just they were going to an island in the middle of the ocean to nest there. So somehow the experiments were affected by this fact, because the number of dives, the number of times the sensors was getting wet, was amplified by the fact that these birds were nesting in an island. So as you see, there are a number of papers that addressed the spurious original data and criticized under different perspectives the levi flight foraging hypothesis. But above all, I don't know whether the levi hypothesis is true or false. I don't even think it's a sensible question per se. I mean, no theory is true or false absolutely, right? But for sure, it's a very popular and thought-provoking assumption. And you can see here the number of papers per year that consider levi walks. So it's really exponentially increasing. So it's really, I would say, it's a very active and interesting field of research. So together with Serena Di Pierro and Giovanni Giacomin, we thought a bit about this phenomenon, and we tried to address the question in a possibly rigorous mathematical way, by starting from very, very simple considerations and trying to use as much as possible the framework of fractional and non-local equations. So the idea is that we are introducing a number of efficiency functionals for the optimal foraging strategy in several specific, very, very simple situations. So the case in which there is only one target, one prey, located in the proximity of the predator. The case in which the targets are sparsely distributed. The case in which there is a single target located far away from the predator. And the case in which there are two targets, one close and one far from the predator. Now, you may think that these situations are way too simple to understand biology, and I fully agree, but still, I mean, they represent typically the model situation that the predator has to deal with, right? Either you have a target nearby, or you have a target far away, and then you start again your motion. So I would say that to start with, even these simple cases are kind of interesting, and they provide the possibility of giving precise, explicit computations in a very simple way. So differently from the existing literature, we really rely on the fractional Laplacian diffusion. So we don't think that the forager restarts the strategy after hitting the prey, just that the forager is diffusing with the law and hitting the prey that it finds by following the diffusion. I mean, this is, I don't think it's an unreasonable assumption from the biological point of view. I mean, after all, the animals move by themselves, and they eat the food that they find while following a sort of natural kind of movement. I mean, that looks to me what happens to the sharks. I mean, at least in Australia, right? They travel randomly, and if they find a surfer and they like the surfer, they eat the surfer. And different from the existing literature, we don't add further parameters to the problem. So most of the literature took into account the notion of direct vision, saying, okay, if the target is close enough, then the predator eats the target. This sounds very natural from the biological point of view, but from the mathematical point of view, has a drawback of adding an additional parameter which is difficult to measure, of course, because you don't really know what the direct vision for a given animal is, and somehow it makes the mathematical a little bit more involved. Also, different from the literature existing, we take into account the time average of foraging success. Most of the literature takes a given time. But we think that, I mean, it's also natural to look at the average of success. It doesn't really matter whether or not the animal is eating now, but the fact that the animal has eaten in a possibly long amount of time. Also, this is a mathematical, maybe pedantic aspect, but we analyze the role played by possibly different normalizing constants. So if you have worked with non-local equations, you know that there are some normalizing constants that in most of the cases are not really important, but they do depend on the fractional exponent. So whenever you want to optimize on the fractional exponent, it may be worth to keep these constants into account, because they may affect one way or the other the final answer. So since we happily work with the simple situations, we are able to find simple solutions. So the solutions we find are explicit and are given in closed form, relying only on elementary special functions. So by special functions, I mean the gamma function or the zeta function and so on. So I think that this is a great advantage, because you don't need to run sophisticated simulations. And somehow everything is explicit and under control. So you can develop an intuition of the model by relying on functions that somehow we know very well. So the formulation, the mathematical formulation that we take into account, as I was saying, is based on fractional diffusion. So we consider the fractional Laplacian with exponent S. And for a reason I will discuss in a second, we restrict to the case in which S is larger than 1/2. This is also a difference with the existing literature. Most of the literature would take into account all the parameters S from 0 to 1. But this creates a difficulty that I'm going to explain in a second. So, we take the classical heat equation with the fractional Laplacian, and we have a diffusion coefficient that we call kappa to the power 2s. I mean, this is just a notation, and so U represents the distribution of predators. So we think that the initial distribution is a predator settled at the origin. So the initial position for the function U is a delta fixed at the origin. Now, speaking about the diffusion coefficient, we take into account mainly two possibilities. Either the diffusion coefficient is normalized to B1, or the diffusion coefficient is a weird number. Well, of course, kappa equal 1 seems like the natural choice. But I would say that the more natural choice should have been actually the second one, because this strange constant is the one that comes from the probabilistic interpretation of the Levy work. Okay, so you have already two possibilities that you can take into account and two models that you have to deal with. Then the idea is that one has to quantify the notion of success. So, for instance, we thought that the nice functional that the forager may want to maximize is the one that that we wrote here. So, suppose that you have a distribution of prey P. Well, the probability of encountering the prey is given by the product of the distribution of the prey and the distribution of the forager. Okay, if they just encounter randomly, you may suppose that the probability for the forager to eat the prey is proportional to the number of prey, but it's also proportional to the density of the predator. So you have a product between P and U, and you average over all the space, because you are taking all the possible points in which these encounters take place. But as I was saying, you also average over time. So you fix a time big T, and you take into account all the possible encounters between the prey and the forager. So this number somehow should represent the quantity of food that the animal has eaten. Okay, then you would like to maximize this, but there is a price to pay. So, of course, while the animal travels, it consumes energy, and so the idea is to divide this success functional by a term that we call C, that is the cost of energy consumption, and the ratio between these two objects is a suitable efficiency function that one would like to maximize. Okay, so if you believe that this is a nice functional to mimic the quantity of food eaten by the animal, the issue is how to measure the consumption of energy. And this is a very, very tricky argument, because one has several options. The easiest would be to divide by the total time T. So in this way, if you divide by T, you measure how much food you eat in a given number, in a given time, okay, in a given amount of time. This is perfectly fine. Another possibility, however, is to divide by the average mean displacement. So you are saying it's not the time that is really important, but the length that you travel. And the two things may be different. So if you divide by the average mean displacement, this is one of the reasons for which we are assuming S to be larger than one half, because this quantity is only defined when S is larger than one half, otherwise it's infinite. But for S larger than one half, it's explicit, and it can be written in terms of explicit function. Okay. Notice that there is the dependence of the diffusion coefficient kappa here. So different choices of kappa produces different average mean displacement. So again, it's important to keep track of all the constants if you want to maximize the efficiency functional in this setting. Okay, so of course, it's difficult to say what is the right one, because it depends possibly on individual preferences. And I think that life is a matter of taste, after all. So for a person, or for an animal, or for a species, one choice could be better than the other. So my time is almost over, so I would just like to show what happens in some cases. Okay, so for instance, suppose that you just put a single prey at the origin. Okay, this is the simplest possibility that you can think of, but already the situation is not completely trivial because, for instance, if you let's think about the easiest possible case. So the diffusion coefficient equal to one, and the energy dispersion equal to time. Now it happens that the optimal is s equal to 1/2. This seems to confirm the previously found choices by Viswanathan and others. Even in this case in which the prey is located next to the predator. This was, at least to me, very counterintuitive because I would have suspected that if you have a prey nearby, you don't need to move much. Okay, it's there, why should you move? But the fact is that the smaller the S, the less regular the diffusion. So it's true that a small parameter like s equal to 1/2 allows the predator to have long jumps and so miss the prey right away. But since the heat equation is not much regularizing, you still have a big mass concentrated at the origin. Okay, so this is the justification for which s equal to 1/2 is optimal. But let me say that it's an optimality which is very unstable for large time. So it develops a pessimizer that we call ST that approaches the optimizer 1/2. So the Levy strategy is perhaps better from the theoretical point of view. But after all, the classical Poisson strategy with the classical random walk and the classical diffusion is more reliable in this case. So let me show what I mean by more reliable. So for small times, the maximum is attained, the maximum is infinity, and it's attained at s equal to 1/2. And the right side of the picture would correspond to classical diffusion. So if you look at the first picture, classical diffusion is absolutely bad. You should go fractional. But then if time increases, the curve starts bending up. So at some point, you see that you develop a minimum here in the middle, and the classical diffusion seems to get better and better. So when the time is very large, the optimizer is still theoretically s equal 1/2, but the curve drops extremely fast, so the optimizer becomes somehow unfeasible from the physical point of view. So it is actually possible that an animal in this situation decides not to optimize the strategy by choosing s equal 1/2 because it's too risky. It may be safer to use the old-fashioned classical random walk and the classical diffusion because it's still sufficiently advantageous and more stable and safer. Okay. Yes. So the situation in which you change the diffusion coefficient is different, but somehow similar. So again, you develop a local maximum close to the classical strategy. I mean, it's similar from this perspective, but let me stress that the classical strategy in this case has zero as an efficiency value. So the classical strategy is never optimal, and the Levy strategy is always in principle optimal, but again very, very unstable. You see, you basically drop immediately, and you develop a maximum that is moving towards the classical strategy anyway. So this is a very tricky situation. Yes, the case in which you look at the optimizers with the average mean displacement is also very tricky, in the sense that for small time the optimizer is in 1/2, but then the pattern changes. So for intermediate time you develop an interior maximum, and for large time the optimizer becomes classical. So here you really have a bifurcation diagram in which you have a monotone decreasing function that at some time develops an interior maximum, and then it changes its monotonicity. Other patterns, other bifurcation patterns of this type occur for the mean displacement. The case of the sparse lattice, well, asymptotically, if the lattice is sparse, is the same as starting at the origin, because the next prey is going to be far away. So you can reduce this analysis to the previous one, and you can perform similar analysis when the prey is remotely located. So I don't have time to show all the cases, but still I would like to emphasize the fact that you create different patterns according to the different parameters chosen. So yes, rather than looking at all the pictures, let me try to show what the conclusions should be. So of course the foraging phenomenon is very complex, and so our philosophy is to be humble and start with simple cases. And also we know that we are not expert of biology, and we are not brilliant mathematicians, so we want to express all the assumptions in a very clear and pedantic way. Better to be boring than saying something completely wrong or be confusing, okay? So we try to work all the models explicitly, and as much as possible to rely on explicit solutions, so that everything is somehow expressed in terms of well-known quantities. Again, we are very pedantic, and we want to keep track of all the structural constants, because they may depend on important parameters, and they may play a role in the optimizing pattern. And this we already saw it. If you change the diffusion coefficient from 1 to a coefficient that takes into account the dependence on the random walk on the fractional parameter, well, you have two different, very different somehow configurations. And also we present different efficiency functionals, because again, different species or different animals may have different tastes and decide to optimize different quantities. And one of the phenomena that I think are very interesting is to detect the bifurcation phenomena, in which changing one of the biological parameters involved dramatically changes the picture and the outcome. So I think that my time is over. So I would like to thank the audience for your patience and attention, and the wildlife for their mathematical creativity.
Okay. Thank you very much, Enrico, for this nice talk. And now for questions in the audience, there's some questions or comments to Enrico.
May I ask one question? Sure. It's probably very, very silly. Very nice talk, Enrico. Thank you very much for that. But my question is very naive. I mean, I was wondering if it makes sense to embed this analysis in a game theoretical framework. I mean, in the sense that the preys might want to avoid being caught, right? Yes. Do you foresee any sort of development in this direction? Does it make sense to ask this question?
Yeah, no, it makes absolute sense. I mean, this work was actually the first for us, which was really taking into account this. But I agree. I mean, there are a number of variations that should be studied more properly. I mean, at the moment we wanted to start a bit the business and to set down a number of assumptions we are confident to work with, and also to see if people like it or think it's complete nonsense, right? But no, I agree. I mean, once we agree on this setting, I think that the game can start and we can make the prey move. So at the moment, we are just putting single preys that wait to be caught, which is not just not. It's not silly, I mean, from the biological point of view, because there are predators which eat plankton, for instance, and the plankton stays there without moving, so that it's not completely silly, even this simple case. But I agree that the next game is to look for the interaction between the predator and the prey.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. And very nice to see you.
My pleasure.
Thank you, Henrique. Thank you, Edgar. More questions? Do you have other questions or comments?
I have a question for Enrico.
Ciao, Nicolò.
Ciao, Enrico. Thank you a lot for the beautiful talk, as always.
No, thank you. Thank you for attending.
And I want to ask you if, I mean, a model with more spatial variables is so very difficult, so too much difficult or not?
No. This is also exactly the next step we want to do. I mean, many things are in common. To be honest, we wanted to focus on the one-dimensional case because it is the case which is more consolidated in the literature. So when I said that the levy flight hypothesis is under debate, I would say that it's under debate in dimension one, and it's even more under debate in higher dimension. So we said, okay, to avoid creating confusion, let's start with dimension one, in which more people have a common background and agree on some phenomena. But I agree, then the next step is to do it in R2, in R3, and for my taste, in Rn.
Of course. thank you a lot.
Thank you.
Okay, any other question? Enrico?
I have a question. Is it possible to have a nonlinear model?
Yes, of course. Yes, again, the nonlinear model would be the one to consider at the end. We started with the linear diffusion because we thought it was the easiest possible scenario, and in this way we were able to find explicit solutions, right? Relying on linear methods. The nonlinear one is cooler, I agree, and it's more realistic, and it's the one that one has to study after all. But I fully agree. This is just the first toy model to understand something, but the nonlinear one is the final target.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor.
Okay. Any other questions? A quick one. So if you know that, thank Professor Enrico again.
It's nice to meet you. Muito obrigado. Obrigado.
Thank you, Marcelo, and thank you a lot, Professor Enrico Baldinocci, for your amazing talk.
Thank you.
To continue.